always been.
Lazy brave,
Good morning, Bubba.
My name is Bubba. This is my compatriot here, Naomi. She's what have
Hi,
you
Naomi.
Done something?
Nice
she did
to,
something
nice
with
guys.
Her hair. I can't. It was, I can't tell what it is.
Wow, that's crazy.
Oh,
it's,
she didn't
it's
shave.
Different.
That's
it's
what
definitely
it is. She
different.
Didn't shave today. Awesome. No, Amy. What is her name again?
My name's Ty.
Okay, that Hi. Is Ty. Ty is helping us out. Naomi's feeling really, really rotten and crappy, and she's got the stuff right.
Sorry,
and
Naomi.
Yeah. So. Anyway, glad to have you here. Glad to have you here. We got to make this announcement. It's Palm Sunday. We're getting ready for the Palm Sunday Parade. You guys, you know, you could go in the Palm Sunday Parade
you
if you want.
Be part of the Palm Sunday Parade.
Kids, let's see you run off to Miss Kate, and she's in the fellowship hall. So anybody age 2 to 200 is welcome. See, these guys, these Jesus freaks here, they're
there
going.
They are.
Go ahead. Go into the, they're in the fellowship hall, and we're going to do our Palm Sunday parade. We do this every year, and it's literally fun.
It's one of my favorite things that we do here at Inspire. It's awesome.
And last service when we did it, it was funny because I couldn't help myself. Remember that thing called COVID? And we were live streaming, so there was nobody here, and the camera was right there, and I remember Tim and Harrison running in front of the camera with palms doing that. So
on the way to church, I saw a guy on riding a snowmobile, and he had long hair. And I thought, whoa, is that Jesus? Is he coming on a snowmobile
well,
today?
Could be. I don't know. But it's Palm Sunday. We're glad that you are here. And let's just open with a word of prayer.
Sure. Father, help us to remember that peaceful, easy feeling that you give us. It's that time of year where we are just so desperate to see the sun and so desperate to get out of this snow, and help us to focus on you this Easter season. Help us to remember this wonderful, glorious parade of you entering the city mm-hmm. on what would be such a hard week for your followers and mm-hmm. not knowing the truth of the glorious sacrifice and the resurrection to come. Help us to glorify you in everything we do. It's in your mighty name that we pray. Amen.
Hey, would you stand up with us today and sing as loud as you can? There's a few less people here today, all right?
Well, you are the Lord, the famous one, famous one. Great is your name.
Yes, it is. And for all you've done and yet to do, and with every breath we're praising you. Yes, we are. Desire of nations and every heart. You alone are God. You alone are God.
You are the Lord, the famous one, famous one. Great
Well, the morning star is shining through, and every eye is watching you, revealed by nature and miracles. You are beautiful, yes you are. You are beautiful. Pray, Father, you are the famous one. It is you who we celebrate today. We celebrate you. We worship you. We bring our gift of worship and praise to you, wrapped up in many, many different ways. In the very sweet name of Jesus, all God's kids said, amen. You may be seated. I see a few palms back there. But I don't see Kate. Do you see Kate? I see Kate. There she is. Are we ready for the parade? 2, 3, 4. Woo! Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God, Hosanna in the highest.
Sing glory.
Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings.
Come on!
All hail King Jesus, all hail Emmanuel, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, bright morning star, and throughout eternity, I'm going to praise.
Come on.
Woo! Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for joy. We thank you for these great kids and even the big kids that helped us out today, Lord. And we just praise your name. And we just pray that you'll reach into this place and be part of our service today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hey, Rob.
Hey, what?
Do you realize it's only 346 days till spring?
Yeah, we canceled spring this year. We were going to do it, but then we decided, why not go back to winter? We skipped it, and so we try again. You can be seated. Thanks for
being
here. It'd
be cool to have Palm Sunday where we could actually have real palm trees.
Yeah, and you'd have to cross-country ski to church. Yeah, that'd be nice.
But okay.
Hey, good morning, everybody. My name is Rob Pesky. I'm a pastor in training here. You met Ty earlier. He's one of our fine worship leaders here, and we're going to run through some announcements because, as always, there's a lot going on, and especially this week. It's Holy Week. If you didn't know, this is the beginning of the marathon. There's just a ton of stuff going on. Before we get into all of that Holy Week stuff, though, we've been talking a lot over the last few weeks about this marriage encounter retreat that we're having. Life happens.
Life does happen.
We have to postpone it. The people that do this workshop, that plan it and are the presenters and stuff, had some life changes happen. And so we are going to postpone, which is sad, but it could be good. You know, maybe if you were interested in going, but the weekend was no good for you, or you just didn't have time to get signed up, there'll be another time later on. But we're just, you know, it's life. It's what it is. And so we're just going to make the best of it. So anyway, sure. If you signed up for that, you probably got notified already. If you were thinking about it, think longer, I guess. I don't know. That's good. Okay. So,
it is Holy Week.
It is Holy Week, and you can see the schedule up on the screen there. There's a ton of stuff going on.
Yeah, the big thing is there's no Ignite on Wednesday. Our Ignite worship team will be leading our service on Friday, though. But before that, on Thursday, we have our annual 7 p.m. Passover Seder meal. Do you want to explain
a little
bit about
that?
This
is a service we do for our fifth graders and their families because it's their first communion service. So they're going to get communion for the first time, and we do the whole traditional Passover dinner with them. And if you're interested in being a part of that, we live stream the whole thing, and there are instructions on our website, like the food you need and the way it all will work. And so if you want to do that Passover meal along with us online, you can. We've got 22 or 25 families.
Yeah,
we're not sure they're all going to fit in the room, so we're going to figure that out. So we appreciate you, if you want to come and watching online for that. But then Friday is a normal, I don't know, what's a normal service? It's here.
It's here. It's Friday. It's at 7.
You're welcome to join us, and we'll live stream that too. Sunday is Easter Sunday.
Don't
here.
Come here.
Don't come
Do
here.
Not come
You'll
here.
Be lonely. The doors will be locked. We're going to be at Bismarck High School in their auditorium at 10:30.
Mm-hmm. One service.
One service. You don't need to register or pre-sign up or anything like that. It's a beautiful auditorium, and it's a chance for all of us to actually be in the room at the same time, which I think will be kind of cool.
Have we had that since coming into this building?
No, probably not.
No.
So anyway, we're kind of excited to have the entire Inspire family together for that. So join us on Easter. Invite friends, coworkers. Again, I always say this. I love Christmas and Easter because it's the one time of year when you can invite anybody to church and no one will think you're weird. Okay? Hopefully they don't think you're weird on other times too, but it's a safe weekend to invite. So step out if you got that friend that you've been wanting to maybe invite. And I don't want to make it weird. You know, we work together. It's a good weekend to say.
It would be weird if you invited someone you don't really know to join the Easter choir.
It would be weird, but cool.
But it'd
like,
be
why
really
not?
Cool.
Got a coworker
and
who
I already
sing?
Got these boys to do Palm Sunday.
Yeah,
so why
choir
not sign
now.
Up for the Easter choir?
This is your last chance to sign up for the Easter choir. You can do that online. You can text Ty. We've got a pretty good crew.
Yeah.
16, 20 people signed up already.
We're going to have a whole bunch of people singing, and it's going to be really, really great. You don't have to be a great singer. You don't need to know how to read music.
Nope.
But if you're interested, just like Rob said, text me or sign up on the website, and I'll get you the music as soon as possible. We'll have a rehearsal on Saturday morning at BHS, and then we'll do the one service.
And it's all ages. We have families who have signed up, like mom and dad, kids, grandparents. Anybody can do this. It's fun. And if you sign up, you get to reserve seats on Easter for yourself. So, if you want the primo seats, the aisle seats, you can get out of there really fast.
I'm
not supposed to say that anymore. I'm a pastor now.
It's okay.
I shouldn't have said that. But anyway.
It's okay. It's fine.
No, we just want you to be a part of it. We want you to be part of this family, and that's what it's about. And speaking of that, we do offering here every week, and we do it a little differently than a lot of churches. We're not going to pass a basket around. We've got some boxes outside the doors here and our main doors. You can go online. You can text. There's a million ways to give. But we just want you to understand that part of worship is giving and being generous. And I know that's a tough thing, and I know people get hung up on the money and stuff like that. But I'm assuming if you're here, it's because you want to grow in faith somehow. And sometimes giving's a great way to grow in faith because it does take some trust. It does take some faith to actually take these things that we feel like we earned and we deserve and give them away, but God is calling us to be generous. And so we just want to encourage you to be generous. We try to tithe here, which is 10%, which is a lot, and that's hard, and we don't expect you to be there at this moment, but we expect you to grow in that direction. So that's what offering is about around here.
One last thing, we do have a movie night coming up April 12th. Yeah. That's from 5:30 to 8. It's for pre-K through 5th grade. It's $5, parents, if you just want to drop your kids off for the night.
And then you go wherever you want.
I totally get it.
Like, sometimes my wife and I go grocery shopping without anyone complaining.
Sometimes
it's incredible.
My wife and I just drop the kid off at grandma's house and we just hang out.
Yeah.
It's the best thing ever.
I've napped during parents' night out. It's wonderful. You do whatever you want. Maybe you want to go out and have dinner or something. I don't know. But anyway.
Yeah, feel free to sign up on the website for that. Like we said, pre-K through fifth grade. Otherwise, I think that's all
it. Yeah, stand up and greet the people around you. If there's someone you don't recognize, introduce yourself.
People online, it's good to have you here. Feel free to greet the person sitting next to you.
Morning, Mitch. Morning, guys. Morning. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to Inspire. Thank you for braving through the blizzard that wasn't quite the blizzard, right? Well, we're probably thankful for that. Today, we continue in kind of this combination of Palm Sunday, but aligned with that in our devotional that we've been doing all year long, Parousia, preparing for the return of Jesus, is the topic of grace and humility, and how grace and humility perhaps are the ultimate way that we can prepare for the return of Jesus. Now, to get us started, I want to ask you a question to start with. What do you do, or maybe I should start with, how do you feel when you find out that someone insults you behind your back? Now, raise your hand if you've ever had somebody do that to you, insult you behind your back. Very good. The other 30% whose hands are up, you're probably the ones doing the insulting. But I think it's a pretty universal experience. And then there's a difference between how we react and how we respond. There is no sin to have emotional reactions. Sometimes as Christians we think, well, I should feel bad for getting my hackles up when I hear somebody did that to me. That's a pretty natural reaction. But how we choose to respond, in other words, what do we do with that emotion? Do we just give in to that impulse and then seek to pay back that person with another insult behind their back? Or how do we do that? How do we respond? Because how we respond is the indicator or the reflection of the degree that we take seriously following our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, to get us started with that, and as you kind of meditate on that question, how do I react and then how have I responded? By the way, let's just have a moment of confession together. Just raise your hand and give me an amen if you are willing to admit that you have not always responded to something like this in the best way. That's right. Absolutely. We all are human. But Jesus desires to transform us past that. And He will. He will if we let Him. I want to show you a clip from the TV show Ted Lasso. Now, if you're not familiar with Ted Lasso, it's a pretty delightful show. And it's about a football coach played by comedian Jason Sudeikis from the Midwest who takes a job as a soccer coach in the English Premier League in the UK, in England. Now, I want to just say this. This is not a kid-friendly show, okay? So don't say, oh, Pastor, you had a family show. No, this is not a family show. It's pretty earthy. There's some language. There's some sexual stuff. And yet this show is full of moment after moment after moment of redeeming things. Very, very interesting. In the clip I want to show you, Ted has been insulted behind his back by a former coach of his, a guy named Nathan Shelley, who now is coaching another team. And Nathan insulted Ted at a press conference. And now, of course, the press being what the press is they get Ted in his press conference and they want to dig the dirt. They want to foment the conflict, right? And so they ask Ted, what do you think? Do you have a comment about what Nathan said about your former coach? Well, let's watch how Ted responds.
Yeah, Sarah. Hey, I like the new hair color.
Thank you.
You do it just for fun or you want to break it?
Both.
Yeah, I get it. What you got?
Coach, how are you feeling about the unanimous opinion that Richmond will be relegated again at the end of the season?
Yeah, it's true, isn't it? Expectations for us are as low as a rattlesnake's belly button, huh? But hey, we got 38 chances to prove all them folks wrong, though, right? Yeah. And my hopes are as high as a giraffe's top hat. Next question. And if it is, why is a giraffe wearing a top hat? Don't ask me, man. Go ask a giraffe.
Coach.
Yeah, Marcus.
Mark Sedebaya, the Independent.
Congrats on the new gig.
Thank you.
What do you got for me?
Do you have any response to the comments made earlier today by your former assistant coach, Nathan Shelley?
Yes, I do. Yeah. I thought it was hilarious. I mean, he came and got us, didn't he? No doubt about that. Hey, but that's Nathan Great for you. You know, he's the same way on the pitch. You know, he'll find the tiniest little weakness in a team and just want to attack that. Yeah. I mean, he's a junkyard dog, man. And smart. They're real lucky to have him over there at West Ham. I wish him the best of luck. I guess I'm a little surprised that's all he could come up with, especially against me. You know, not one joke about me being a dumb American? Come on, man. Sitting there. I mean, I'm so dumb. Y'all supposed to say, how dumb are you? Gary?
Why?
Well, I mean, it's just classic joke structure. Give it a shot. I mean, I'm so dumb. Lloyd?
How dumb are you?
Well, I'm so dumb that the first time I heard y'all talking about Yorkshire pudding, I thought it was a fancy word y'all had for dog poop. Yeah. I mean, I'm so dumb.
How dumb are you?
Yeah, all right, well, you know. Well, whenever I text someone over here about money, I still spell pounds LBS. Yep. Look, man, I'm not a great coach. Probably ain't. You know, I've been doing this sport now for 3 years, and I still get a chuckle every time someone talks about a handball violation. And not one crack about my appearance? About this mustache? I look like Ned Flanders is doing cosplay as Ned Flanders. I mean, when I talk, it sounds like Dr. Phil hasn't gone through puberty yet. I'm more corny than Kevin Costner's outfield. Ooh, I lost you on that one. Yeah.
Swing and a miss.
Yeah. Field of Dreams? No? I guess y'all don't really like baseball here, so why would you like movies about it? Well, hey, how about this one? Regarding my panic attacks, I've had more psychotic episodes than Twin Peaks. I mean, I'm so crazy.
How crazy are you?
There we go.
The humility to take a situation like that and just flip it. It's a thing of beauty. It really is. So today we talk about humility. Please stand for our reading this morning, which comes to us from Luke's Gospel, Dr. Luke, chapter 14, verses 7 through 11.
When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give the person your seat, then humiliated, how you will take the place of least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of all of the guests and all of those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who are humble will be exalted. The word of the Lord.
Please pray with me. Gracious Father, we're going to start this morning by just confessing together, agreeing with you that our impulses, our instincts are so often to be defensive and to seek to exalt ourselves, to defend ourselves. All of the responses that are not born of humility. We invite you, Holy Spirit, to fill this place, to be our teacher, and to teach each and every one of us that unique thing we need to hear today, that we might become more like you, Jesus. Humble, but in that humility, immensely powerful. We pray this in your name, all God's people said. And you can be seated. Alexander the Great, on a horse. Napoleon Bonaparte, on a, not just a horse, a big horse. Robert E. Lee, on a big horse. His big white horse, Traveler, was his name. All considered great and powerful, impactful leaders and conquerors of history. And when we look at the artwork that is so often depicting these great leaders and conquerors, they are often, if not always, on a big war horse of some sort. It's so impressive, so majestic. It's as if to be a great leader in history is equated with being on a big horse. I know something about big horses. I have a few. But then there was Jesus. Then there was Jesus. And we read in Matthew's gospel on Palm Sunday, they brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A donkey is not a horse. I love listening to my horses when they're neighing and kind of playing with each other, and they get all uppity and they start running around. And even just with three of them, as they're running and galloping around, you can hear that, you can feel that in the ground. It's something very just noble about it, right? But I will tell you that the neighbor's donkey, it is not that way. Hee-haw, hee-haw, hee-haw at 4 a.m. Please be quiet, donkey. Okay? And yet this is what Jesus sits on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted with me. Ready? Hosanna to the Son of David. You're not shouting. Oh, come on, folks. We can do better, right? Let's try again. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. The irony of history's greatest and mightiest leader, and I dare say conqueror, comes in that he comes meandering into Jerusalem upon the most modest member of the equine community. Not a big, beautiful black or white war horse, but a donkey. The most humble of the whole family group, like Jesus was. And yet, of all the great leaders in history, he was the most, and is still today, the most impactful. Now, if you don't believe me, go back to Napoleon Bonaparte. He understood it. Napoleon said, Alexander, Caesar, Charlemagne, and I myself have founded empires, but upon what do these creations of our genius depend? Upon force. Jesus, though, alone founded his empire on love, and to this very day, millions would die for him. And by the time Napoleon said that, millions had already died for and in the name of Jesus Christ. The love and humility and sacrifice of Jesus would inspire the most loyalty of any leader in history and continues to today. Bonaparte would go on to say the following. He says, I know men, and I tell you that Jesus Christ is not a man. Superficial minds see a resemblance between Christ and the founders of empires and the gods of other religions. That resemblance does not exist. There is between Christianity and whatever other religions the distance of infinity. Not because we're better, not because us Christians are better than the Hindus or the Muslims or the Jews or the Mormons or the whatever. Not because of that. But because the one we worship is transcendent and unique among all other figures of human history. Jesus is the one and only. John 3:16. Houtos ho theos, agape son, cosmos. In this way, God loved the world. Etokin, we own, we us, that he gave his monogenes, only unique son. That's what it literally says in the text. Only unique son. There is Jesus, and then there's just everybody else, amen? And before him, we are all equal, right? And yet this Jesus, in all of his splendor and glory, chose to display it in humility. The words of Napoleon are simply echoes of what Paul wrote to the church in Philippi towards the end of his life, when Paul said, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. So Paul's getting up all up in our business. He's saying, hey, in your relationships, if you want them to be healthy, if you want them to be happy and meaningful, and if you want them to reflect the way that God loves within himself and God loves you, then have a mindset the same as Jesus. And what was that mindset? Well, he goes on. Do not consider, who being in what? Very nature God. I love the Greek there. Morphe Theo. Who being transformed into the presence of God on earth. That's kind of what it's saying. Did not consider equality with the Father something to be used to his own advantage. In other words, he came full of the power of God. And we see that in his life, right? But he never used it for his own glory or advantage. All he ever used that for was to find a myriad of ways to love people, right? Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. And the word there for servant, it's doulos. It's actually slave. Slave. Being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, fully God, fully man, he what? Humbled himself. By becoming obedient to death, but not just any death. At that time, the most humiliating of all deaths, even death on a cross. Therefore, oh, stop. Whenever you're reading scripture and you see a therefore, see what it's there for. It's telling you something important. Therefore, read with me. God exalted him to the highest place. And gave him the name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And ladies and gentlemen, the world throughout its history, since Jesus up to this day, has been full of people who refuse to acknowledge Jesus Christ as Lord. But the day is going to come when he returns and it becomes apparent that the truth that has been preached about him is in fact reality, that every knee, regardless of whatever their stance was before that, will bow before him. C.S. Lewis would later say that it's impossible, he says, it doesn't matter that you bow before him then when it has already become impossible to stand up. And that day will come. To the glory of God the Father. In his book, Mere Christianity, Lewis would go on to say that humility is not thinking less of yourself. That's kind of a cultural myth. Well, being humble means I need to be kind of weak and quiet and passive. No. That's not humility. Humility is not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking of yourself less. And then he would go on to say that the humble man isn't even thinking about being humble. All he or she is thinking about is, how can I love my fellow man? How can I help people? How can I pour myself into people? One of the things I kind of love about the Ted Lasso show is he's this coach, and he's kind of weird. He's kind of got that Midwest hick thing going on. And he's in an interview with one of this British press, a guy named Trent Krim. And Trent's pretty tough, and he's pretty critical. And Trent says to him, so are you worried about winning enough to keep your job? And he says, no, it's not my goal. My goal isn't winning, Ted says. My goal while I'm here is to help each and every man on my team become the best version of themselves. The winning will take care of itself. Ted chooses a humble path of serving his players rather than his players serving him. I love that. Just love that. Humility is not thinking less of yourself, it's thinking of yourself less. When I think of my life and the people who have made an impact on it and the people that I can remember, and I bet this is true for you as well, these are the people, not who I looked at and said, wow, they're so good at this or they're so good at that. They were the people who somehow loved me and poured themselves into me and said things, words of encouragement to me when I needed to hear them, or believed in me when I couldn't believe in myself. And maybe it was a teacher for you, maybe it was a coach or just some other adult. Raise your hand if you have somebody you remember that, who wasn't the best at what they did, but they cared about you, and you remember that, don't you? And this is the stuff that makes the world in the kingdom of God go round. It's the only currency that matters. Another thing that I've discovered in my life is it's exhausting to pretend to be something I'm not. Can I get an amen on that one? It absolutely is. It's exhausting. Young people, you are entering that phase of life already and continuously now where you're going to be tempted over and over to do that. Pretend to be something you're not. Pretend to be good at something when you're not. Pretend to be the best at this, or to pretend to be a part of this, or whatever it is. It's exhausting. Humility is freedom. It's the freedom to not have to run on that never-ending treadmill. Humility lets you breathe again. In humility, you don't always have to win. You don't always have to know the right answer. You don't have to always be right. In humility, you don't have to have everything figured out. I literally remember the day when I realized that. I don't have to have everything figured out. All I got to do is trust God one day at a time, and it will be okay. Do you have any idea what a relief that is? It's great. With humility, you don't always have to be the strong one. Men, I'm talking to you. You don't always have to be the strong one in your relationships. Sometimes it's okay to be weak and let somebody else care about you. But most of all, folks, the most powerful aspect of humility is that humility, in humility lie the seeds of healing and forgiveness. It takes humility to go up to somebody that you know you've hurt or wronged and to say, I'm sorry. I was wrong. Please forgive me. I would suggest that that's one of the strongest things a person can do in this life, is to do that. And the most freeing. In humility, we can forgive and be forgiven. The lack of humility keeps so many relationships from reconciling with each other. And as I say that, I know that right now a large portion of you, right at this moment, are thinking of people in your life that you know you need to do some reconciling with. Aren't you? You sure are. Yep. But often we get stubborn. They hurt us, and we hurt them, but of course, not as much as they hurt us. And we sit there like this. And then we pray the Lord's Prayer, and we say, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. All the while we say we worship a Jesus who says to all of his followers, if there is something between you and your brother or sister in Christ, he says, go and talk to them. Notice that he doesn't say, wait and extract your pound of flesh first. Doggone it, Jesus, why do you always have to be so tough on us? That is his command. And if there's anybody in the history of the world who has earned the right to tell us that, it's Jesus. Amen? Who hung on a cross and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Go. So uncross your arms, folks. 3 years ago, I came to a point where I heard those words of Jesus. There were four people in my life that came to mind at that time, that I knew I needed to do some reconciling work with. And so I thought, well, I need to reach out to them. I need to be obedient to Jesus because he says go. He doesn't say wait. And so I need to reach out to these people and I need to find a way to just say, hey, I am really sorry. I'm going to own what I need to own, and here's how I was hurt, and can we reconcile? And so I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go to the store. I'm going to see if I can find some cards about forgiveness, like a greeting card, right? About forgiveness. And so I went to a couple of regular stores, Target and such. Do you think I could find a single card about reconciling and forgiveness? We have cards for everything out there, don't we? Happy birthday, happy anniversary, so sorry about your situation, hope you feel better, and on and on and on and on and on, and every conceivable holiday, and we have no cards out there for forgiveness and reconciliation. So I went to the Christian store, no cards on forgiveness and reconciliation. Now, I'm not trying to get after the Christian store, because I asked him, I said, what's the deal? He says, well, our manufacturers, suppliers just don't make them. Would you agree with me? What an irony that of all the things that we have greeting cards for in this world, perhaps the greeting card we need the most today is the greeting card that affects forgiveness between people. Can I get an amen on that one? So when I realized that, I decided, okay, well, I'll just write letters to him instead. And, you know, I got kind of a variety of response. One person didn't respond at all. Two of them responded with just a simple, "You're forgiven." Well, thank you for owning your part of it. But I got a beautiful letter from another person, and we were really able to reconcile. It was great. And we can't be accountable for how people respond to us, but we are accountable to the Lord for us reaching out, right? But then after that, I thought about the greeting card thing, and I did the most dangerous thing I could think of. I went and talked to Pastor Ernie. And we began to talk about that, how strange it is that we don't have those cards. And so Ernie and I began to work on the whiteboard. And we came up with 30 cards, 30 different cards to help people break the ice for forgiveness. And they're all out on tables in our fellowship hall. Now, let me say this. Nobody's trying to make any money on you. We printed them. And I want you to think about those two or three people you need to do some forgiveness work with. And then I want you to go out to that fellowship hall when we're done and look at those cards and see if you don't find one that might just fit the bill for you. Might be just the right thing to break the ice. Let me give you a couple examples quick. If you're the one that hurt somebody, maybe this one would be good. "I was an idiot," it says. "Open it up, please forgive me." Boy, that's rocket science, isn't it? And then write your note. Or maybe you have a situation where, they did a little something wrong, I did a little something wrong. Well, maybe this would be a good one. "I was wrong, you were wrong. By the way, I did the artwork, real proud of it. Let's fix this." Or maybe it's a fellow brother or sister in Christ. "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. I know I don't get to hoard forgiveness. Do you want to meet and mend things between us?" There's 27 more out there. I want to not just invite you, I actually want to challenge you. When you're done today, go and look at them. We got them kind of spread out. You can bump shoulders with people. I saw John Gottfried looking at him earlier after the first service. I said, "John, anybody who works in state government, I'd always have at least a 5-pack of these in his desk." At which point then he said, "Well, actually, I was hoping you could help me pick out 3 of them that my wife could give to me." I said, "I don't think you got the point of the sermon, John." He's such a clown. But you get what I'm saying, right? The best way, right, that we can prepare. So, we want to give you tools. Because how great would it be if we were known as the church where people had the humility to forgive and to be forgiven and to take the first step? If we could be the church where healing happens. Well, I started with Ted Lasso, and I'm going to end with Ted Lasso. The scene I want to show you, Ted's boss, the owner of the team, her name is Rebecca. And Rebecca is going through a bitter divorce with her husband, Rupert. Rupert owned the soccer team, but in the settlement gave the soccer team to Rebecca. And you might guess that Rebecca chooses to get back at her husband by making a mess of his soccer team, thus hiring a football coach from America. But at one point, Rebecca realizes that in her unforgiveness, she's becoming a monster and hurting good people. And she goes and confesses to Ted. Let's watch. It's a pretty sweet scene.
Ted, I lied to you. I hired you because I wanted this team to lose. I wanted you to fail. Then I sabotaged you every chance I've had. It was me who hired that photographer to take the photo of you and Keely. I set up the interview with Trent Crim, hoping that he would humiliate you And I instigated the transfer of Jamie Tart, even though you'd asked me not to. This club is all that Rupert has ever cared about, and I wanted to destroy it. To cause him as much pain and suffering as he has caused me. And I didn't care who I used or who I hurt. All you good people just trying to make a difference. Ted, I'm so sorry. If you want to quit or call the press, I'll completely understand.
I forgive you.
You what? Why?
Divorce is hard. And it doesn't matter if you're the one leaving or if you're the one who got left. It makes folks do crazy things. Hell, I'm coaching soccer, for heaven's sake.
In London.
I mean, that's nuts. Yeah. But this job you gave me has changed my life. Gave me the distance I needed to see what was really going on. Yeah, but you and me, we're okay.
Come on, just shake this hand. My arm's starting to get...
You know, I think that if you care about someone and you got a little love in your heart, there ain't nothing you can't get through together. You know what I'm saying?
You're not just talking about us now, are you?
Maybe. Maybe not.
Okay.
I'm gonna go change your practice, training, practice, whatever. Who cares? I seen you down here, boss. You liven up the place.
I love it when Jesus covertly shows up on a TV show. What better way is there to prepare for the return of the great forgiver than to become forgivers ourselves, so that when he shows up, he can look into our hearts and see himself there. And what better path towards that than humility? Quit being exhausted. Quit pretending. Embrace being humble. It's awful freeing. And if that means you need to do some forgiveness work with people, do it. Do it. That healing, that's the stuff of heaven, you guys. And it's the best way we prepare. Amen? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're grateful that you lead the way, that your sacrifice makes possible forgiveness, and then that you offer us that forgiveness. But then you challenge us to not just receive that forgiveness, but to allow that forgiveness to flow through us to the world around us, that we become partners with you and agents of healing of all of creation. That one day you'll return to make all things new. But the preparation for that begins with us becoming agents of reconciliation and healing in this world. Followers of you, countercultural. And so we follow you, Jesus, the great mighty leader and conqueror who comes with humility on a donkey. Help each of us to embrace how we need to respond now this week to your words of love, of forgiveness, and then challenge. Go share it, you say. Go share it now. And if that means maybe you need to grab a couple of cards, so be it. We'll do that. We just want to be a church that you're pleased with. Help us to prepare for your return.
in this way. We pray this in your only unique name. Amen. Amen.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness.
Stand
of God.
And sing of the goodness of God with us. Come on, let's sing.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. Oh, in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God.
Sing all my life.
All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am made, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Your goodness.
'Cause your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I'll give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I'll give you everything. It's your goodness. This is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Father in heaven, how good you are. How good that you are a God who forgives, who provides us with the ability to forgive. Help us to make our hearts as light as feathers. Leave all our heaviness and our weight at the door and be able to worship you all of our days. It's in your mighty and holy name that we continue to worship. Amen. Thank you. sun to rise. You lay it down to rest. You hold this heart of mine. You hold my every breath. Such an awesome God, so mighty, so the living bread. You're such an awesome God. You're so mighty, so holy, so wonderful. Such an awesome God, so selfless, so
the most exciting thing I can ever think of. How about you? Woo! Turn to your friend and say, what an awesome God we have, and say it with gusto. I don't know. Warning, God was in the house today, and so you're going to leave a little bit different than you came. Just warning you that if you took this thing serious, my goodness, there's going to be a transformation happen into your life. Because most of us, we are stuck on ourselves. And we need to get over that. We need to come out of ourselves. We need to do something, novel and different, like forgive our brothers and our sisters instead of holding it in. Hardest thing you're going to do in your life, first of all, is going to be forgive yourself. And the Bible says if you don't forgive yourself, how can you forgive anybody else? It's right there in the Lord's Prayer. If you don't forgive yourself, you will not have the capacity to forgive anyone else. And then I'm telling you what, if God can get a hold of you with that one, it's going to be an amazing transformation in your life. And then step across the aisle and take care of yourself and own your wrongs. Own them. You see, husbands, you can pick out your wife's wrongs in a heartbeat. You can come in my office and give me a laundry list of what she does and what she doesn't. Wives, you can do the same thing with your husbands, but how many of you want to come in and say, I'm the one. I'm the one causing these problems in this, and I need to ask my husband or wife or my friend to forgive me. Whoa, that's when revival hits a church. You know what I'm talking about? That's when the Holy Ghost falls on people and people really get saved, and people that don't know God. That's what we're about here. My friends, it's so glad to be in the house with you and to worship with you. We take God serious here, and we take love serious here. I want you to know we love you. And again, if you can't stand the love, Rob laughs at me when I say this, go somewhere else. Find another church if you don't like the love. But listen, let it melt you. Let it mold you. Let it make you into someone different. Here we are, a giving church. Rob mentioned it earlier. We do have boxes. I can see one back there that you can give if you wish to. And also, we're a church of prayer. If you would like prayer, Rob is standing right over there by the cross, and he wants to pray for you. He wants to anoint you, and he wants God to do something in you. Is that a deal? All right, Bob.
I have a deal for them.
Okay.
I'm going to make all of you TV stars, because if you will help us right now, you'll be on the television. We have up next chair stacking music. Timothy, my son, says, have them just stack them in stacks of six, because we have our Seder meal Thursday for our fifth graders. So as a church, we're preparing for our fifth graders. If you don't mind, we got great stacking music. We need these chairs stacked in chunks of six. And Tim said, don't have them move against the wall because we have a cart, but you'll move them against the wall anyway. So let's stack these chairs. Here's some stacking music for you. Those chairs, come on. Well, down around the corner, half a mile here, I see them long chairs run and watch them disappear without love. What would you be now? Woo! Without love. My son was Lucy, down around the tracks. She lost her home and her family, and she's gonna be coming back without love. Where would you be now? Without love. Well, in North Central, answer them Santa Free. I'm pushing my mind, you know they run away without love. Where would you be now? Without love. Oh, the pistons keep on burning, and wheels will ride around. Steel rails out cool and hard, in the mountains I got down.